Album Flash presents the Everly Brothers.
It's about, I guess, in his 70s, early 70s, they put the statue. He died, what, about 65, 66?
Oh, hey, Donald, Palace.
The Queen's not there.
Nope. It's raining too hard, I guess. Some of the best times of my life I've had in London. It just is a fun place to be, and the English people have always been very good to us.
Phil and I first came to England in 57. I mean, that's a really quite a while ago. So we were really young kids, and they loved the music. They said, "You kids are having fun with that music, aren't you?" And that attitude has always impressed me about England.
The Royal Albert Hall is here in London, and I wanted to play the Royal Albert Hall.
Albert Hall is one of my great memories of our gig there playing together, and I can't call that a gig at all.
For the reunion concert, it gave me a lot of confidence that we could do it in the studio.
Our first album in over 10 years.
I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be, it's going to be nice to... And the music's going to be good. It has to be good. Recording it's not a party, but it's technical. A lot of technical things to do. Get it right.
The Everly Brothers, they did their reunion concert. They did two nights at the Albert Hall, and I was there. In fact, I went to their rehearsals as well at the Dominion Theatre. And about a week after, the phone went one Sunday evening, and it was Don Everly. He said, "Hey, me and Phil are thinking of getting back together on a more permanent basis, and we're going to record, and will you produce the album?" And I just couldn't speak. I couldn't imagine, like, why me? But I just said, yes, you know, I mean...
Well, the reason Dave Edmunds, I think, became the producer is his interest. And I felt that he had done his homework, so to speak. Also, I did know his reputation, especially in the business, that he had a deep respect for rock and roll and was very capable in the studio, which was primary importance to Phil and I. I think Phil and I had a meticulous sound, and I think that Dave Edmunds has a meticulous sound. I was aware of Dave Edmunds' production of the Stray Cats, and I knew he was into basic rock and roll, which is an important element to have inside.
Here's a man that has looked into it and dealt with it, you know, what it is that we were doing. And I felt that maybe he could be a caretaker of that sound, and because you've got to have that in the studio. You've got to trust the people on the other side of the glass. You can do all the creating in the world in a studio, but if it doesn't get on the tape, they're lost.
Hang on, Phil. Come to your seat, right?
Okay. You need me to do anything, or am I okay like this?
Just for the moment, you're all right there, okay?
We had some fabulous musicians. John Giblin on bass, Pete Wingfield on synthesizer. I've never worked with so many good musicians in one studio. The way records are made a lot these days is you get a drum computer machine and you program something in, and you build things up from there. But this way, we were doing it with musicians, like the old way, the proper way, I guess, you know, with a real drummer and real musicians playing together. It was great.
Yeah.
They always had fantastic songs, you know, I mean, equal to Beatles stuff. I mean, really, some of the stuff they did, it was just incredible. So I called Barry Gibb, Jeff Lynne, Paul McCartney. I thought that was the way to go, just to ask the best writers in the world, you know. Don sent me a cassette of songs of his, and there was some really good stuff on there.
I think most of Donald's songs have derived from his personal experiences and how his life has gone. Almost any great writer, and Donald is one, you'll find that their song is almost like all their songs are like diaries.
The song, "You Make It Seem So Easy," is basically how difficult it is to be reciprocal in a love affair when someone else thinks that you're dying and suffering and they seem to be just getting along wonderful.
How are you doing in there? Wanna make a record?
Jeff Lynne came up with the song Story of Me, and I had spoken to Dave on the phone from Nashville months and months before we really got into the studio. Dave was finishing his album, and
I was in the studio with Jeff Lynne from ELO, who was producing some tracks he'd written for me.
David asked him, said, how about a song for Don and Phil, you know, they're coming over.
And he did, and he actually had the backing track of it on a cassette, and he played it to me, and sang the song. It's called The Story of Me.
The song title alone was enough to make me keep pushing for it.
Don and I are two individuals, really, but we're looked on as a one person. And when you say the story of me, you can't say the story of me's, you know, which we'd also laughed about. But third party, the Everly Brothers are a third party, and it's really the story of me, the Everly Brothers, the third party.
To me, it sounds bit like pieces of Phil and I's life, kind of in a collage.
He came down to London, rewrote it twice for us to, as we did the first take, you know, and he worked out harmony parts and worked out. He's quite a perfectionist, and it's really a delight just to work with him.
It's quite unusual for us, but I think it really worked really well.
See, they're intuitive singers. They don't actually understand singing. I mean, people like myself and other people I know in the business who sing, we learned how to do it. We learned how to hold a note or control a vibrato or how to count bars so you know when to come in. They never did. It's all intuitive, especially with Don, like the solo bits he does. If you ask them to do them over and over, they'll be completely different each time. I always thought listening to the old stuff, if you listen to... Each time we meet, love, or something like that in Let It Be Me, that he, that's, that was it, that was the tune. But no, each time he does it, it's a different tune, maybe different words.
My father said, you and Phil singing together can be wonderful. And he said that all my youth. And he taught us what we know. He taught me to sing harmony before Phil could learn how. Phil was a little younger than I was. And then when Phil's voice was higher, we changed parts, and Phil sang the harmony. And once you're into something like that, you begin to act upon it. And we began to change it. We did something else with it, of course, as everyone does. And then when John Lennon and Paul McCartney came along, they took what they had heard and put their stamp on it. And it'll continue to, and Simon and Garfunkel, people continue to do that.
Donald's lead is, I always use it like when water runs down a mountain, it cuts a path, and you have to flow and follow that path, and the path has to find its own natural, the lead has to find its own natural flow, and the harmony just has to flow with it, and that's the way I've always looked at it.
The song of Following the Sun, basically a song about not being happy where you are in your situation, wanting to get out of it, and looking at, looking for something, searching.
If I roll another day, I think I'll pack and go away, leaving you cold-hearted, looking for love somewhere, following the sun. If I stay another day, you might take my dreams away.
Idea what it's like to pick up the phone and to to call Paul McCartney and ask him for a song. It's horrendous, but I did it eventually, and he said, yeah. He said he'd send me a song. In fact, he said it so readily, and I thought he was just sort of putting me off, you know. He was giving me a stock answer. But no, sure enough, in a few weeks' time, he came through with a song, and we've done it. It's called Wings of a Nightingale.
A great songwriter, when you do his song, it's easy to sing. The words have meaning, and they get inside you internally very fast, and it makes it a special event. It really does.
And we took it in the studio, and it turned out really well. I think it sounds like Phil and I a lot, and I'm happy with it.
Thanks, Paul. Something involved in the music and rock and roll and the aging of rock and roll, which Don and I are obviously a part of.
I do know this, that if Phil and I are fortunate to live to our 70s or 80s or something, then people are going to want to hear us sing Bye Bye Love. If they're that old, you know, if they can remember it. Even some youngsters then will want to hear us sing it.
There seems to be a sense that we've all kind of grown up together, everything's okay. What we chose as youths was a good choice. The music has matured and has lasted, and it's been entertaining all of our lives.
I think we've got a great Everly Brother record. I think it sounds just like we used to sound, except it's 1984.